In this video, we'll talk about the similarities and differences between the different types of cell division. When talking about the different types of cell divisions, one of the things that's important to realize when distinguishing one from the other is that all of the events that are unique to meiosis occur during meiosis I. And in fact, one of the best ways to summarize meiosis I is through the phrase that homologs, or homologous chromosomes, they pair, recombine, and separate. Now, pairing means that the homologous chromosomes, they find their matching pair, they find their matching partner. Recombination is the exchange of material between those two homologous chromosomes. And then separating happens during anaphase I, when the two X's separate from each other and move towards opposite poles. What we'll find is that the general steps of meiosis II mimic what occurs in mitosis. The only difference here is that in meiosis II, we're starting with cells that are haploid, whereas in mitosis, typically we're starting with cells that are diploid. So when looking at mitosis compared to meiosis I, in this example, again, the diploid number is 4. And the haploid number is 2. We see in both cases, we're starting with cells that are diploid. Both cells have 4 chromosomes to start, 2 large chromosomes and 2 small chromosomes. When we look at metaphase, we see that all the duplicated chromosomes line up on that metaphase plate. However, when we compare metaphase 1 of meiosis 1, we see that it's the bivalents or tetrads that are lining up on that metaphase plate. Comparing anaphase of mitosis, it's the sister chromatids that separate from each other. Yet when we look at anaphase 1 of meiosis 1, it's the homologous pairs that are separating from each other. And so by the time we get to telophase and cytokinesis, in mitosis we had started with the diploid cell, and we end now with 2 diploid cells. Yet in meiosis 1 we had started with the diploid cell, and we end with 2 haploid cells. The differences between mitosis and meiosis I is that in meiosis I, it's the homologous chromosomes that pair, recombine, and separate, compared to mitosis, where each duplicated chromosome lines on that metaphase plate, and it's the sister chromatids that separate from each other. Now, when we look at meiosis II, we see that meiosis II will be very similar to mitosis. The only difference is that we're starting with cells that are haploid. And after they go through metaphase II, anaphase II, and then telophase II, we still end with cells that are haploid. Both of the divisions, meiosis I and meiosis II, are required to get us these haploid cells that end up becoming the gametes. The last topic to discuss in relation to meiosis is what happens when there's a mistake. What happens when the chromosomes don't separate properly? Well, this is known as nondisjunction. Nondisjunction is the term for errors during meiosis. These errors, they can occur when duplicated chromosomes or homologous pairs fail to separate in meiosis II or meiosis I, respectively. If these homologous chromosomes or these duplicated chromosomes do not separate, the result of these errors would be gametes produced with an improper number of chromosomes. If these gametes then participate in fertilization, the resulting offspring would have improper numbers of chromosomes. Here we see an example where the haploid number is 2, the diploid number is 4, Yet the egg cell is haploid plus one. There's one extra chromosome in that egg cell. So when sperm and egg fuse, the resulting offspring, the resulting zygote, is diploid plus one. Now, what is the consequence for having extra chromosomes? Well, it turns out it really all depends on which chromosome it is. A particular genetic disease or disorder in humans is known as Down syndrome. This is a condition where an individual has an extra copy of chromosome 21. Down syndrome is also sometimes referred to as trisomy 21. Now, this additional chromosome can result in developmental delays. There are certain physical features and traits and characteristics associated with this disease and disorder. It can result in poor vision, also a protruding tongue and a thickening skin around the back of the neck. And you may think, wow, chromosome 21 is a really bad chromosome to have an extra copy of. But it turns out that trisomy 21 is the only non-lethal trisomy of an autosome. Having three copies of any other autosome would be fatal. In fact, this would typically result in a miscarriage early in pregnancy, because having an abnormal number of chromosomes, especially for the autosomes, is very serious. Here we see a karyotype of a human female who has Down syndrome. Now we know it's a female because the two sex chromosomes are the same size, they're homologous. And we know this individual has Down syndrome because they have three copies of chromosome 21 instead of just the regular two copies. Nondisjunction can happen during the formation of sperm or during the formation of eggs. It isn't automatic that this is caused by one parent or the other. However, one of the quirks of the human reproductive system is that females are born with all of the eggs that they will have for their entire life. So that means as the mother ages, the eggs in her ovaries also age, and the cellular machinery that's present, that's used to separate the chromosome, also ages and begins to break down. And so, the incidence of having an offspring with Down syndrome increases with the age of the mother, because the error rate in gamete formation increases for women as they age. Now, this is not the case for males, because males are not born with all the primary spermatocytes they will have. In fact, they don't start producing primary spermatocytes until puberty. And then from puberty onward, there's a constant production of new cells making those sperm cells. Now, again, that's not to say that there are never mistakes in the production of sperm cells. It's just that the frequency or incidence of those mistakes do not increase as the man gets older, in the same way that the error rate increases for females as they age. You may wonder if it may be possible to have an abnormal number of sex chromosomes. And the answer is yes, and in fact, having abnormal numbers of sex chromosomes are typically far less detrimental than having an abnormal number of autosomes. So nondisjunction can also affect the sex chromosomes. In humans, biological sex is determined by the presence of a Y chromosome. And so, if an individual has no Y chromosomes as their sex chromosomes, their biological sex will be female. Whereas if they do have a Y chromosome, their biological sex will be male. Now, what if an individual has two X chromosomes and a Y chromosome? Well, that individual will be biologically male. They'll have a condition known as Klinefelter syndrome. Now, individuals with Klinefelter syndrome, they have normal intelligence, normal lifespan, they may have some reduced fertility, but having this abnormal number of sex chromosomes does not automatically impact their gender, their sexual orientation, or anything like that. Biologically, they will be male, though they may have some more feminine characteristics, and there may be some fertility issues. But really, the changes are so slight and subtle that you wouldn't necessarily be able to tell. Even more surprising, males who are XYY or females who are XXX, these individuals have such subtle changes in phenotype that phenotypically they're normal. They wouldn't know that they have an abnormal number of sex chromosomes. although there may be some fertility issues, because meiosis doesn't work as efficiently if an individual has an odd number of chromosomes. Now, what if an individual has one X chromosome and no additional sex chromosome at all? That individual will be biologically female, and they'll have a condition known as Turner syndrome. Now, these individuals with Turner syndrome, they may have slightly shorter stature, and they'll have some fertility issues, but again, they'll have normal lifespan, normal intelligence, not impacted in the way that having an abnormal number of an autosomes would impact an individual. So with that, we've finished our discussion of cell division. In the next section of this course, we're going to start talking about genetics and how traits are passed from one generation to the next. See you in the next videos.